Barasa. And then after Barasa, we will have Honorable Carol Agwanda in that order. Thank you so much, Dr. Mary Goretti. You have 2 minutes to just give us a feel of the academy too.
Wow, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Terry. Thank you so much, participants, colleagues, for a wonderful week well spent. It has been a good learning process, sharing, and as much as I was a facilitator, I've also learned a lot. The journey has been awesome, and I only pray that from the people you've received in this academy, most of them, if they'll be vying for the seats next year, may they win. And as a teacher, if a pupil or a student or a learner passes, that is by winning an elective post, it is my joy and the joy of all facilitators in the room. So we wish you well. Please make us proud by posting good results. We are here with you in the journey. Take our contacts and let us deliver. Remember, the space is for both men and women, but in this case, we wish our women to take it because of the numbers we have. The former president of America, Barack Obama, once said that you cannot have a match where half of the players, more than half of the players are outside the field. You will not score. And this is what has been happening in the world. Women are the majority and they are not in the playing field. And therefore we cannot realize development we desire. And women leaders present here, go for it so that we can champion or bring up bills in the house which will look and take care of our interests like health, education, and women economic empowerment. Wish you all the best. Thank you, Five, for the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Colleagues, you can have the video just to appreciate our facilitators as Dr. Barasa is going through the presentation. Dr. Barasa, you have the floor.
Thank you, Rachel. I think I've learned that learning is a lifetime journey. And you can imagine for 28 years I've been learning and you'll never learn enough. Academy 1 was different. Academy 2 has added more value to me as a person and also as a facilitator. And to Fawe, you thought it and it's a good idea. May we reap the fruits come 2022 and come 2027. At least we can reap for 2 seasons from this kind of academies. And we'll have made a permanent mark in the journey towards gender equity, gender equality, and gender justice. Why not? Rwanda has achieved it. Our neighbors have achieved it. Kenya cannot remain at that level of 21%. We need to not even get to 30%. We need 50-50. The Millennium Development Goals now are being celebrated where the target is 50-50 is not 30 anymore. We don't need an affirmative action. We just need 50-50. I would encourage my sisters to go for it. They have the potential and they have the capacity to compete. So they must compete to win. I'm happy with their engagement throughout the sessions in Academy 2. When we began Academy 1, we thought it was going to remain like that. But my fellow facilitators will agree with me that Academy 2 has been more engaging, more rigorous. For both the facilitators, we have learned doing it better. And also for the participants, they have learned to come in because at the end of it, they will be on their own. And they are able to practice, bring out issues where they don't understand. We encourage them to go on that journey. And it's important that they continue that way. Again, I was also happy that there's now a realization that men must engage. I used to be lonely, but I'm seeing many men again coming to the fore so that they become gender warriors to fight this cause. I will continue with my journey. Already I'm writing a book on my encounter with the women movement, but I will encourage that we bring more men who have been obstacles to become the champions. If you want to catch a thief, send a thief. Of course, men are not thieves, but we want them to be on the forefront of fighting for gender equality. Why? Because society gains. Why? Because men also suffer from some of those atrocities. Women are partners, not being told behind every man who is successful, there's a woman. Besides every man who is successful, there's a woman. And besides every woman who is successful, there's a man. We are human beings. We must be treated equally, and we must treat our sisters, our wives, our mothers, our aunt and our grandmothers also equally. My wife is somebody's daughter. My wife is somebody's mother. Mm-hmm. So when you mistreat somebody's daughter, you also like saying daughter has to be mistreated. Thank you very much, Terry. And thank you very much, Rachel, for the opportunity.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Barasa. Thank you so much. We appreciate you. I would like to invite Mary Muyonga. Please, let's keep it to 1.5 minutes as possible, 2 minutes if possible. Thank you, Mary Muyonga, one of our facilitators also. Please go ahead. You have the floor.
Thank you so much, Rachel. And thank you and congratulations to all the young women who put themselves up there. I think I just want to say I'm very, very proud of them for taking the step. And we hope that what we have trained them through this week will help them in their journey. There are some for them to reflect on, and there are some for them to use for their strategizing. So crossing fingers, and we are keeping our eyes open to see how many of us cross over to the other side. Thank you very much. And thank you, Fawe, for the opportunity. Thank you.
Merci. Merci beaucoup, Mary Muyonga. Merci, merci. And now we have Japheth Muthomi. Please communicate with us, please, Japheth Muthomi. And then we have Valerie. Please unmute Japheth.
Sorry, it doesn't even have audio.
All right, Valerie, please go ahead. And then we have Honorable Carol Agwanda. 1 minute each, please go ahead.
Thank you very much, Rachel and the Fawe team and the academy and all the participants and just everybody who was involved in this particular convening. It's been very, very important, and our rallying call, just like my colleague, Dr. Mary Goretti has said, we have the numbers. We are important in the discourse and the governance of this country and the governance affair. We have that which we bring onto the table that is unique and will definitely miss out if we are not represented. So let's go for it. Let's arm ourselves with all the knowledge you've gotten from this academy and just claim our rightful place and do what there is to be done by our leadership. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Valerie. Thank you so much. Next, we have Honorable Agwanda. You have 1 minute to go. Honorable Agwanda, if you're in the room. And as we wait for Honorable Agwanda, we have also our facilitator, Jen Amiri. And then finally, I'll give Terry just 3 minutes, Terry, to just wrap up in terms of we still have some time in terms of what the facilitators have felt from the participants that we've been having in Academy 2. Honorable Agwanda, are you there? All right. Honorable Agwanda, I can see you. Please unmute. Thank you so much. As we wait for Honorable Agwanda, Terry, please go ahead. Give us a feel of what the academy has been, what we have been doing for the last 2 weeks, and now this is Academy 2. Please give us a feel, especially in terms of the module and what we have been training our participants in 3 minutes. Go ahead, Terry.
Thank you so much, Lecho. Thank you, Joanne, for this. So this is what we have been doing. We started last week with Academy One, which had a total of about 35 participants, all young, 18 to 35 years, who are either aspirants or already in political journeys. Academy Two started this week on Monday, and the overall objective of what FAWE is trying to do, and that's how we all came in on board, is to enhance the participation of women, Joanne, please, participation of women in politics and decision-making, and build awareness and strengthening the capacity to formulate and advocate demands for women's political participation. This is the overall objective of the FAWES and partners initiative of this WPP program. And therefore we came on board as facilitators to support the team at FAWE to be able to implement this. Of course, the learning materials had already been developed earlier on, which part of us were also involved in the validation. Later on, we were trained as trainers through the FAWE experts, and therefore we came on board now from last week to facilitate these sessions. We are also here noting that this week has also been very inclusive. We have had participants who are able to differently, who are able to join us, and the whole learning experience has have been made very good through our sign language interpreters, and we want to appreciate them for that. The major, very major outcome of this training for this week and last week's First Academy was for the participants to be able to develop their personal development plan that involves their political journey in the next one or so years. And this has been achieved for both Academy One and Academy Two. And Academy Two also has have been a lot more vibrant in terms of developing these plans. And as we are saying, we will keep supporting them even after the end of this particular modules or other trainings today. Last slide, John. We have been able to cover 10 modules. Sorry, Joanne, previous, sorry for that. We have been able to cover the 10 modules that are in the learning materials of the FAWE WPP program. So module one is what we were looking at, the introduction to politics and governance, moved to module two, which is the international legal frameworks. Module three is politics and women engagement. Module four is women in election. Five, communication, public speaking and blooding. Six is gender and gender mainstreaming. Seven is women's political influence, sustainability, and men engage. Moving to module eight, transformational leadership, disability mainstreaming in women political participation, and work-life harmony and self-care. So each of these modules is taking us to the next module. And in each of these modules, we have sets of activities that we have been able to engage all of us with the participants. Last slide, John. So the methodology that we have been using is definitely the adult learning methodology, because we believe that everyone that has been coming to this class is whole, is complete, and we are just coming to share ideas and add experiences. So we have been through a lot of facilitated discussions, case studies, group work discussions. We have had excellent guest speakers. Thank you to FAWE for bringing all these guest speakers from different parts of this continent to speak to us. Interactive lectures, we have shared personal experiences, takeaway assignments, reflections, case stories. So for me, as your lead facilitator for this week, I'm honestly proud of FAWE, the work that Rachel has also put into this as the coordinator of the program. We are so happy to everyone who has been part and parcel of it. Facilitators have done an excellent job. The participants have been very good. Our sign language interpreters, excellent. We are so proud to be the pioneer facilitators of the FAWE Academy. Thank you, let's show it back to you. Thank you, Joanne.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Terry, and thank you for taking all our guests and all the viewers who are joining us on YouTube and those who are joining us on the link on what exactly we have been doing this week. We are so excited. It's been an amazing week, and we thank God for really giving us this opportunity. So allow me now to just invite two of our participants. I have Cindy Onyango on behalf of the participants, and then We will have Grace, who will just speak on behalf of the participants for 2 minutes each. So Cindy, are you there? Please go ahead on behalf of the participants. Just give us a feel of what has been, what you have been going through for the last 1 week. Cindy, the floor is yours. Cindy, are you there? Okay, please unmute. Cindy Onyango, please unmute. All right, as you wait for Cindy to unmute, I can see Grace is already on the screen. Grace, you have
the floor.
Cindy, Grace, already you have the floor. Grace, please go ahead. Yes, go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Grace. Okay. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, I am glad to have participated in this WPP Academy, this training. I am using a sign language interpreter. And I want to thank the sign language interpreters. I want to thank FAWE team and the guest speakers who joined us for this academy. All the facilitators that joined us for this academy. Good afternoon, all of you. Okay, thank you. So first of all, I am very, very honored to be here to give the vote of thanks and even to say what the academy has been for us. First of all, I want to thank Rachel very much. And together with FAWE as an organization and all the team members from FAWE. First of all, this was a very, very wonderful WPP Academy. The training was just amazing. All of us have benefited from what we have learned. And also, I want to thank FAWE very much for including persons with disabilities in this academy, especially deaf people like myself. Ashura is still here with us. Ashura is with us. I believe this training has guided us to be somewhere. Has directed us to go somewhere. It's not easy for other organizations to be thinking about people with disabilities in their programs, specifically deaf people. They are always left out. People think that they can't. And people have all perceptions about us. Thirdly, I want to thank FAWE very much also for bringing together very powerful guest speakers and facilitators. Let me give a few examples. Professor Jacqueline, she told us, as women, we need to have a goal and have a strategy, have a way to communicate our strategy, have someone to mentor us if we want to achieve what we want. And again, I'm reminded of Professor Nana's speech, the FAWE Africa Board. She said, We women, we have very different capabilities, skills, desires, ideas, motivations. What means is that we cannot change one another if we don't even start to change ourselves first. If we don't bring our synergies together. For me, that was a very powerful message, and it's a take home for me. And also, I want to appreciate the facilitators. Many, many facilitators. We have Terry, we had Valerie, we had Baraza, we had many of you. I can't mention all their names. Allow me not to forget some facilitators like Caroline, who facilitated about the disability mainstreaming. Honestly, we got that facilitation. It's not just anywhere we get this kind of facilitation. This training was very, very important, and we got a lot of information that is very, very helpful, that is take home for all of us. Without forgetting the sign language interpreters who have been working with us this week. They have played an excellent role in making sure that we participate. Because myself, as a deaf consumer, I would not have been able to participate and even to speak the way I'm speaking if it were not for the interpreters. I use my hands to speak, and the sign language interpreter gets what I'm saying and communicates to the hearing people. That is how I was able to walk through this journey of the academy through a sign language interpreter. And I would like to recognize some of the participants who are with me in this training, who decided to leave everything that they were doing. People are busy doing other things, but they came for this academy. I believe with the knowledge and information that we have got from this academy, it is a strong foundation for us to be able to continue, and we want to applaud ourselves for it. And I don't want to forget the technical team that has been working behind the scenes to make sure that this is successful. You have sacrificed, you are doing so many things behind the scenes. I really want to thank you for that. And finally, I want to ask you to give a pat on your back for everybody. Give yourself a pat on your back, and God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. Please, colleagues, let's all do the sign of thank you. You do this and you know. thank you so much. Thank you so much, Grace. And we appreciate you and all your team and the interpreters. We really appreciate you. Wow, wow, wow. And finally, just for 1 minute, I would like to give now the floor to Cindy Onyango. You have 1 minute, Cindy. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much to the directors, Fawe, members of the faculty, facilitators of Academy 2, and all the partners involved, fellow participants, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
So my name is Cynthia Onyango, an aspiring NCA from Sidindi Ward in Ugunja constituency, Siaya County. On behalf of the course participants of the FAWE Academy 2, I would like to take this humble opportunity to thank you for the well-deserved presentation, very well delivered. The 1 week of enlightenment has undeniably been a life-changing experience for most of us. And I have no doubt that lessons learned will be put to good use, and that from this academy, we shall have 100% transition into transformative leadership across the country that will actually change the narrative and bring positive change in our communities. I believe that the true mark of a leader is the willingness to stick with a bold course of action, even as the rest of the world wonders why you are not matching up with the step of the status quo. With this training, thanks to the organizers and facilitators, we are empowered to go out there and tip the balance on the ground as we are stronger and more confident that we can. Professor Oduol started us off on a powerful note with real life experience and reminded us on the need to make ourselves visible. Then we also had underscoring the need for research and data. We know about legal frameworks from Valerie, and communication skills and etiquette, thanks to Mr. Mudomi. Dr. Goretti did not disappoint by taking us through the history of women in politics. Mary Muyoga wowed us with a powerful presentation on gender mainstreaming, not to forget Professor Nana and Professor Catherine with transformative leadership. We were really challenged. Honorable Caroline Agwanda and Dr. Kabue were here to remind us about our colleagues who are enabled differently. And Sarah came in to excite us with resource mobilization for campaigns. All these to mention just but a few. Dr. Baraza has woken us up. For those of us who only knew that we want to get into the political space but did not know where to start, now we have concrete plans to jump start our bids. Asante Nisana. Special thanks go to Dr. Terry and Rachel, who kept us awake with the interludes, Joanne behind the scenes, keeping the presentations going, making sure we have the right slide on the screen, not to forget the entertainment with beautiful music during the breaks. And lastly, not to forget our sign language interpreters. To you all, we say Asante Sana. To my fellow participants, I wish you all the best of luck as you pursue your dreams and urge you to put to practice all that we have learned this last 1 week. Let us all remember that a better world is possible when we are all intentionally making our little corners of the world better, and that we have to go out there, show up and take the power. As Professor Duol told us that she told her party leaders, let us all say Duol Odonjo Eko, and firmly, resolutely run for public office. With that said, I call upon my fellow participants to turn on their videos and join me in a round of applause to appreciate Pawe and the facilitators of the academy for a job well done. Asanteni sana sana. Asanteni sana.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Cindy. Thank you so much. Wow, wow, wow. What an amazing way to end our 5-day for Academy 2. And as the facilitators can tell, we were here also for Academy 1. Amazing, amazing, amazing. I do not want to say more. Ladies and gentlemen, allow us now to move into our panel session where we have Honorable Simone, who is the chair, Fawe Africa Board, who will share her experience in 5 to 10 minutes about what is her personal experience in the political journey. What is her personal experience in her political journey? She will also share with us what it means to be a woman in a political leadership position. And last but not least, she will also give us a hint on what it means to build those movements. How is it that she was able to bring in those different stakeholders, and who are those different stakeholders that we need to reach out to talk to engage with, so that our political journey can be a success. Honorable Simone is the chair of Fawe Africa Board. For those who are here with us in Academy One, she moved us with her story on how she was able to make it in that leadership position that she is in. She's going to tell us about it. Honorable Simone, you have the floor. Please take the center stage. Thank you so much. Please unmute. We are able to see you.
Thank you, Rachel. I'm amazed about what has been happening the whole week, judging from the intervention of those who have taken the floor just before me. Bravo to you all. Keep going. We're getting there slowly. I know you told me I've got 5 to 10 minutes. I wasn't so sure how long this was going to be. Anyway, maybe I need to take you back a little to the how it works in the Seychelles. Absolutely. Seychelles, being a small island state, you know, but we're part of the African Union, as you know. A cabinet minister does not run for elections in the constituency as such. I think we follow more the American system. A minister is appointed by the president who is elected, and the person is chosen based on his her background and experience and qualifications. He or she may have been working as a technocrat or can come from a political party. In my case, I was serving both as a technocrat and also as a member of my, as an executive member of my political party at the time, when I was appointed as minister in 1989, and in which position I served for 14 years. I had been continuously elected, though, to serve as a member of the executive of my political party then, from 1983 to 2011, we were elected every 3 years, and I was continuously re-elected, altogether for 28 years. I opted out in 2012 as I wanted to take a break, and since I no longer believed in the political leadership of that party in the direction that it was taking. However, deep down in my heart, there was this inner Simone telling me not to give up. And with the wind of change, in early 2015, I joined the opposition and we formed a strong coalition, which is the Union Democratique Sisséroise. I was made the Secretary General of the One United Opposition, and in which position I still serve up to date. We lost the presidential election in 2015 by only 173 votes. The case was referred to court, but the judgment was biased. We did fight it though, and instead we concentrated our efforts on winning the parliamentary elections in early 2016. The opposition won a landslide victory, holding the majority in parliament. The party got better organized, and we kept on working extremely hard from all fronts. In October 2020, our party won both the presidential and parliamentary elections. They were held both at the same time by a landslide victory for both. The new president offered me the position of Speaker of the House, but I declined, as I am planning to retire from politics next year. I am still serving as an active member of the Constitutional Appointments Authority, and I will complete my term in 2024. This is an important institution which is responsible to recruit and appoint constitutional appointees like judges, chief justice, attorney general, auditor general, etc. It is a very important institution, and I'm so glad to be serving on that. Now, my experience, when you embark on a political journey, you need to remain focused. I'm sure you must have heard about this already. You need to be committed, strong, and be prepared to face countless challenges. For example, you need to put up with the infighting within your own party to keep proving that you are as good and even better than the men. Don't I know it? Sometimes we women can be our own worst enemies. We need to hold each other's hands. You have to be continuously walking the extra mile to accomplish the impossible. You have to maintain the strength of character, be bold and not shy away from any responsibility entrusted upon you. Be politely aggressive but firm. Unless you have the willpower to strive on, you may not experience great success as such. Keep going. In spite that the struggle will be tough. Believe me, it will be tough. Having been a member of the executive of the ruling party at the time, I was assigned. I've said earlier on, we don't run for elections as a minister, but within the party, I was assigned specific electoral districts to work with the candidates running for parliamentary elections. I literally had to do door-to-door visits to meet and know the constituents. I had to work with some stubborn candidates, mostly men at times, and continuously impressing upon them to perform by acting as a role model. I had to hold weekly clinics to meet the constituents, hear their problems and aspirations, follow up and give feedback. People will respect you for telling the truth. Avoid telling lies. Respect has to be earned. You cannot demand it. In all the constituencies where I worked, 5 out of 23, my candidates always won with a good majority. And I always felt proud of it. They gained their popularity through my hard work, and all of them recognized and appreciated that, I must say. Now, with regard to family, I was asked to talk a little bit about that. My family was highly supportive in my political career, in my political journey. My late husband stood by me. My mother was my tower of support, especially during the time when my children were still small. They have both passed away since then. During the period 2015 to date, following my move to the opposition, my two sons, who had grown into being adults then, were always by my side in the political rallies, in the meetings, in the debates, and also giving a helping hand whenever needed, because very often I had to stand up on those podiums to speak up at the political rallies. In terms of non-state actors, there wasn't much support there, really, because in my country, the way it works, these non-state actors, they are not supposed to be seen to be taking sides and participating openly in politics as such. However, in my position as a former minister and also a member of the executive of the ruling party at the time, I had a competitive advantage over my opponents, since I could use the facilities of my office, for example, the staff, to assist in many ways, to meet the constituents and to attend to their problems and coordinate meetings and so forth. That was very helpful. The budget was accessible from the party at the time because the president of the country was equally the president of the party. So you can understand what I'm trying to say here. Whereas from 2015, whilst being in the opposition, things were totally different. It was a real struggle whereby I've had to work almost single-handedly with some assistance from the party headquarters. However, it was manageable since the commitment, I talked about commitment earlier on, the commitment and the willpower were there. And the constituents were always willing to assist. We were guided by a strong spirit to win, no matter what. This is what made it. The access of funds, my dear friends, is always a challenge. You need to develop your party and candidate manifesto and campaign on this platform and draw the attention of all concerned. Based on that, you will attract particular sponsors who will be willing to offer grants or assist you in any all sorts of ways. Be careful though with the strings attached. You cannot afford to compromise yourself or your party too early in the game. Always be prudent. You have to keep your weighing scale by your side all the time. In striking the balance between your political work and family life and maintaining this harmony, believe me, it is not easy. This depends upon your particular circumstance, whether you have a supportive husband or partner. In some cases, those of you who have a close relative, your mother, your auntie, your sister, who will stand by to assist, especially with the children. I'm sure many of you have got young children to attend to. Trust is primordial in your relationship, as otherwise it can be an added pressure. those of you who are into a relationship. You must find a way to give attention to the family and to your children. You can get them involved when you are having your activities in the constituency, for example. I used to do that sometimes. This is good so that they can appreciate your work. They need to feel proud of you as you strive for success. It is also very important to have a few sincere friends on whom you can rely on, trust, who will always be ready to give a helping hand, but most importantly, to give you the moral support. We all need that. Most importantly, keep your spiritual life in focus too. You need to look up to God in prayers as you turn to Him for support all along your journey. I was blessed with the privilege of being able to give the support to many others, myself, especially my women colleagues. I used to do that all the time. We all have our own strengths and weaknesses. Please combine these to move you forward. My good friend Welly, now sadly deceased, was purposely standing by me as my speechwriter. You will need that. Along your journey, and as you grow up the ladder of success, make sure that you touch the lives of others kindly, as you will need them as you climb down. From my journey back from being a minister to joining ordinary citizen life, my doors kept opening up and I did not face challenges as such. As I conclude, let me leave you with this quote that a friend had shared with me along my political journey. Your progress in life is determined by your willpower. Willpower has the ability to defeat all other powers. My dear ladies and gentlemen, my dear participants, let the start of your political journey guide you well. Politics is interesting, politics is enjoyable, but politics can be painful. So make the most of it. The pain that you will go through can only build up to your experience to make you a better person in life. Thank you, Rachel.
Thank you. Merci, merci beaucoup, Honorable Simone. Merci. Bravo, 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 merci. Colleagues, please have your videos on. We want to thank our panelist for sharing with us her journey, for giving us her parting shot. Your progress in life is determined by your willpower. So thank you so much, Honorable Simone, and thank you for finding time to be with us. We value you, we appreciate you. We thank you so very much for sharing with us those very important words, of course, with our participants who really are going to the field. So picking up from your own experience, and that will really, really, really help them. Thank you so much, and thank you. And please feel free to be with us, and we appreciate you for really taking time.
I'll stay on for a while. I'm going to see off my granddaughter at the airport. She's going on to UK to be at university. So you can imagine my granddaughter going to university. So she's been part of that journey as well. You know?
Absolutely. Bravo, bravo. Bravo, okay. Et merci.
I'll stay on for a while. Thank you.
Absolument. Merci, merci beaucoup et merci.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Our next speaker, colleagues who are my Anglophone sisters, we have the interpretation button right on your screen. If we will be having also our presenters who will be speaking in French. So please feel, thank you, Joanne. Absolutely, thank you, Joanne. So we have interpretation, French, English. If you go to the interpretation button, you have the options. If you could just go through that, you click the mute original audio, and you will be able to receive the language, your language of preference from our presenters who will be speaking. So please feel free to go to the interpretation button and just click on whichever language you'd like to receive the presentation. So thank you so very much. Dr. Terry took us through work-life balance, which I used to think as balance. And one of the things about learning and being in such spaces is unlearning and relearning. So Dr. Terry told us, Dr. Terry, who is one of our facilitators, told us it's not balance, it's not work-life balance, it's work-life harmony. So that, for me personally, gave me an opportunity to unlearn my work-life balance and to relearn my work-life harmony.
Yes.
So thank you so much. And now I would like to invite one of our guest speakers, Anne Carrier. She was with us, and she is going to give us hints on what does work-life harmony mean for women politicians. What does work-life harmony mean for women politicians? She's going to share with us. Please kindly mute, kindly mute, so that we are able to avoid all kind of interference. Thank you so much. So Anne Carrier, allow me to read Anne Carrier's profile, colleagues. One second, if I could share my screen. Yes, so Anne Carrier is a passionate organizational consultant dedicated to amplifying the performance of individuals, executives, teams, and organizations. She has dedicated herself to helping people create meaningful in their work by creating meaning in their own lives, which results in motivated employees, customer commitment, and sterling bottom line performance. She excels at digging deep to gain valuable insight into her clients and often draws them into uncharted territories for their growth and development. Her powerful intuition, blended with her ability to shift perspective, allows her clients to successfully craft and implement innovative solutions towards their advancement. She's one of the few internationally certified emotional intelligence coaches in the African region, with accreditation from the 6 Seconds EQ Network and International Coaching Federation. She has positively impacted many leaders and organizations in Africa with her emotional intelligence proficiency. Anne is a leadership and management graduate and currently the chairperson of the County Governance Watch, CGW Board. So we are so excited to have you here, Anne. In the morning, just before we took a break, Dr. Terry took us through work-life harmony. Please tell us, as women politicians in the room, how do we manage that? Just give us strategies. And honestly, we need those strategies because you want to be in politics, but you also want to be whole. Anne Carrier, we are so excited to have you here. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Rachel. Good afternoon, everybody. I am so grateful and happy to be here with all these women leaders. I've missed out during the week, but I can get the excitement, I can get the positivity and the great learnings that we have shared from the, because I was listening to the vote of thanks. Work-life balance, especially for someone in politics, this is, it's not something that you ever achieve, it's something that you work at every day. So I'll just share a few tips with you that I've used in my own professional life that have helped me and that work. So Rachel, I'll go ahead and share the presentation.
Yes, please go ahead.
We can see it, Rachel?
Yes, we can. Absolutely.
Great, great. Work-life balance, and Terry told us it's really not balance. It's more of harmony. And we're on the same page with Av, because we're saying there's no such thing as a work-life balance. It is all life. You're not a different person when you get into politics, a different person when you're in your house, a different person when you go to the church or to the mosque. It's the same person. So it is all life, and the balance has to be within you. So this is the secret. The balance has to be within you. It's not something that you try to achieve out there. And I know this looks like most of us. This actually looks a lot like me. My babies are not that age, but yes, we still have them. Even if they are teenagers, we are still doing the mothering, the cooking, the working, and all these things. And sometimes it can get overwhelming, especially if we don't have a strategy, if we don't have a plan of how we go about this. And as I was coming to share, then I looked at statistics about stress and the things that overwhelm people. And I actually noticed that women are more at risk when it comes to stress and all these other things that are related to stress. And look at those statistics. Women report higher levels of stress than men. All the researches that have been done since 2007. I also found out that 1/3 of women are affected by the common mental disorders, depression, anxiety. And sometimes we don't even know it, or we don't even say it because of all the stigma around this. I discovered that depression occurs twice as common in women. And you know, it is the second leading cause of global disability burden, according to a 2020 study. When we look at mental disorders that affect the older people, we discover that majority of them are women. Okay? Then depression, of course, is related to gender-based roles. So definitely this is something we as women are supposed to be thinking about, especially women in politics, because that is even a more kind of stressful environment. Okay? Stress, how it affects our bodies, our minds, our feelings, and all these other things. As you look at that circle and all these things, how many of these can you pick out that belong to you? I'll just give you about a minute to reflect on this. How many of these things can you pick out from the body section, from the mind section? If you're like me, you'll have something on each of these: body, mind, emotions, and behavior. And you can see that stress is really not a good thing, especially not dealt with. And where most of us are going now, those of us who have already started our political journeys, those who are starting now, it's even going to get more overwhelming. So these things are likely to overwhelm us even more. So definitely this is a topic that we should think about as we get into our political journey. So, I love this quote so much as a woman. If you don't want to burn out, stop living like you're on fire. So if there's anything to remember about this session, it's this one. And I always imagine when I watch the movies and see somebody burning and how they're running all over the place. And a lot of times that feels like us women, with all the different roles, all the responsibilities that we have to play. And so we are saying, if we don't want to burn out, we must stop living like we're on fire. Because if we burn out, we are not giving any value to ourselves, to our families, and to the difference, because we're getting into politics to bring transformation to our communities and to our people. If we burn out, we're not going to be able to do that. We are told we cannot give what we don't have. So you must first have it so that you can be able to give it. And a leader leads through influence. People watch you. They notice what you're doing. So if you are burning out, they're going to notice that, and they're not going to be attracted to it. They're going to be repelled by it. I love this. This is what kind of all the aspects of our life, and I call it the wheel of life. And, you know, these are the different aspects that keep the wheel, our wheel of life, rolling. And you can see there's so many things. Some of them we don't think about. Some of them we focus so much on. Some of them we focus so little on, and they end up affecting each other because it's a wheel. It's all connected. You can think of about the wheel of a bicycle and the spokes. Huh? So when one spoke is broken, that bicycle is not going to be able to move. And look at that. We have to think about our health. When it is health, we're not just looking at our physical health. We're looking at our emotional health. We're looking at our mental health. by looking at all these other things that are there, diet, sleep, relaxation. Then there's our families. We all belong to some family somewhere. If you have not started your own, then you belong to a family somewhere. You are somebody's daughter. You are somebody's sister. So this is something we must think about. How much time do we spend with them? Is it quality time? Do we understand them? Do we support them? Our friends, we are told friends are the spice of life. We need to have tight networks. And the speaker just before me has mentioned that you need a support system. There are some people you can go to, people who can help you when you're in those low times, someone you can share with, okay? We have our significant others, our partners, our spouses, okay? That also plays a role in our life. It's one of the spokes, okay? There's our career. There's also financial health. If your finances are not doing well, then there's no way you're going to also be able to balance this one, because money is what helps us mainly achieve all these other things that we're doing. Recreation, okay? Fun and recreation, that time that you go to re-energize, to rejuvenate yourself, doing the things that you love, okay? Personal development, and I'm sure a lot of it has been talked about in this academy, because I know we're even supposed to come up with our personal development plans. So that is also important as we think about life. The environment that we put ourselves in, is it pleasant? Is it motivating? Is it helping us to be more creative? Okay, or is it toxic? Okay, then the speaker before me has also mentioned about spirituality. Human beings have a spiritual connection. We must be in touch with ourselves and also be in touch with what is going on around us. So as you look at that wheel, so you can be asking yourself, on a scale of 1 to 10, how am I performing on all these areas? Where 1 is the lowest and 10 is the highest, then you can kind of gauge yourself and then see where the work needs to be done. So I'm just going to share with you 10 tips in the essence of time that have helped me, and that it would be a starting journey for us to be able to deal with all these things that we are supposed to work on, so that our lives can be in harmony and so that we can go out there and be effective leaders, leaders who perform, leaders who can actually achieve the objectives that we've set out to achieve. So the first one, practice mindful leadership, okay? As you get on this journey, a lot of us begin it, you know, very positively. We kind of have a focus. We know what we're doing. Along the way, that is forgotten. So it's actually knowing your why. Why am I in politics in the first place? Why do I even want to do this? What is my driving goal? Because when things come your way, and there's all these challenges that will definitely come, if you don't know your why, and if the why is not clear to you, then of course you're going to get overwhelmed. What is the difference that I want to make? How do I want to make it? What am I living for? So that has to really, really be clear. So we need to practice mindful leadership, which again tells you you need to keep on every day having some time to retreat into a space where you sit with yourself and go back to your goal, you know, and your objective, and focus on that, because that is what is keeping you moving. And I'm sure as you talked about developing your plans, this came into play. Your why, your objective, it must always be there, very real. The second one, let us work on our mindset. So we have two different kinds of mindset. We can either have a fixed mindset or a growth mindset. And I've given some examples there. A fixed mindset avoids challenges. When challenges come, you either run away or you hide, you know, or you give up. But a growth mindset will view challenges as opportunities, because opportunities only come when there are challenges. Inside those challenges are the opportunities. A fixed mindset will shy away from things that we don't know. And none of us knows everything, you know. A growth mindset will tell us, acknowledge and embrace your weaknesses. I'm not very good in this. I'm getting into politics, but I'm not very good in this. I'm not a very good speaker. I'm not very good at communications. I'm not very good at, you know, social media or technology or whatever. Then you embrace that and see how you can work on it. Yeah, because everything can be changed. Okay. A fixed mindset, we are unable to handle criticism. When we hear criticism or feedback, and there's nobody who is criticized as much as a politician, and more so a woman. So we need a growth mindset, will tell you to learn to give and receive constructive criticism. When we hear someone say something about us, instead of just saying these people are hating on us, what is it that we can learn from them to improve ourselves? I will not go through the entire list, okay? Because you're going to get this and you look at it, but then this is something you need to work on. When you have a growth mindset, things begin to look easier. All the challenges that come your way, you kind of have a way to work around them, okay? And they will not stress you, okay? Number three, track your stressors. What are these things that stress you? And we all are stressed by different things because we have different lives. We live in different environments, okay? So what is this thing that stresses us? What is it that triggers? What are these patterns of behavior that am I doing over and over again and they're not working for me? What are these decisions I keep on making? How do I react in this kind of situations that is not working for me? Okay. So the easiest for me, I started keeping a journal, you know, just looking at what makes me angry, what makes me afraid, what makes me sad. Then that way, even before they come, you're able to preempt them. But it is important to know where are your stressors coming from? Okay. Because if it's life, we all have those all those things, but we need to know what is it that comes to stress us, and then we will have a plan of how to deal with it. Number four is easier said than done, pausing. When we're in those situations, when we are really, really in an emotional state, we're very annoyed, very angry, very, very sad or whatever, let's learn to pause before giving the feedback. And in politics, you're going to get all these situations. Someone will say something about you. And the first instance, of course, is to just respond or react. So let's teach ourselves, instead of reacting, to be people who wait to pause, think about it, think about the outcome that you want. Okay? When you think about the outcome that you want, then you will know, how then will I respond instead of reacting? Because a lot of times when we react, we're not looking at the outcome. And that is how we break a lot of relationships that we need, a lot of networks that we need, because we reacted to a situation instead of pausing. So pausing is a really, really good way where you get in touch with yourself and ask yourself, what do I want out of this situation? Setting limits, again, not easy to do. But we need to set our boundaries. You know, as politicians, we are going to have all these requests coming to us. From within our families, from outside there, everybody wants you to go to every meeting, every fundraising, every event, every, you know, we have to learn how to say no to some of these things so that you're not overwhelmed, because you can just do so much. You're one person. And you remember, we don't want to burn out. We don't want to live like we're on fire. We don't want to burn out. So setting limits, we don't have to attend every event. We don't have to attend every meeting. Okay. So let us learn how to say no. Sometimes someone calls you and say, we've been called for a meeting. Before you even know what the meeting is about, you have stood up, picked up your bag, taken your notebook. When you get there is when you're asking, and by the way, what was this meeting for? You know, let's learn how to set limits so that we don't get burned out. Let us do those things that add value to us. Number six, let's make health-related commitments. There's a lot of science behind why we need to do this, yeah? Because all our emotions and stress is affected by our hormones. So we have got feel-good hormones, and we have hormones like adrenaline and cortisol that stress us. When you're living a healthy life, you're actually suppressing those hormones that bring you stress, and you're heightening the feel-good hormones. So we know this. This we know. The problem is the commitment. Are you committed to it? We know we are supposed to eat healthy. We know we are supposed to sleep enough. We know we are supposed to stay mindful and prayerful. We need to be outdoors, all these things in the exercise. So you just, as you do your personal development plan, this should be one of the things that you put in there. In any given day, how much time am I spending on exercising? What kind of meals am I going to be eating? And it, in the long run, it has a very big effect, overall effect on your entire life and your performance. Getting organized and planning. Once you get into politics, this will be very important. And that way you'll also be able to see from what are the things that are important for me to do, what are the things that are not so important for me to do. So having a list that you keep and say, today this is what I'm doing. And if I didn't finish, if I had five things to do, I did four things, then this one I'll carry over to the next day. But when you don't have a plan and you wake up, other people will be planning your life for you. And this, of course, will end up putting you in a very stressful place, and that harmony will just be broken down. And we've talked about having to balance, and the speaker before me talked about it. You still have a family, you need to spend quality time with them, you still have all these other things to do. So when you have a to-do list, it will help you to know to sift between what is important, valuable, and what is not. Maintaining respect, very important, because respect, if you want respect, then you earn it. So you start by respecting yourself, then respecting those around you. They might not have share the same opinion with you. They might not say it so nicely to you, but for us, for you, if you want to be a leader who will go far, a leader who will get noticed, you always have to maintain respect, you know, and tell someone, thank you, I've listened to you, I've taken your advice, I will think about it. You don't also have to insult them. You also don't have to go out there and do the ranting. So maintain respect, and this will take you very far as a leader, and it will also keep you from getting stressed. Changes will come, very, very many of them. And so instead of hiding or running away, we are saying when you face change head on, it's less stressful. And we are saying innovation is the ability to see change as an opportunity, not as a threat. A lot of changes have come into our lives in the last 2 years, 2020, 2021. But when we look at them as threats, then it becomes difficult. We should be asking, what are the opportunities? This and this has happened. We are here. Before, we used to have these meetings physical. Look at us now, having a beautiful academy online. And this is the opportunity. So as a leader, look around you. Changes have come. What can you do? I didn't get through in that election, or I didn't get nominated in that party. But with that change, what has come for me? How can I use that as an opportunity? Lastly, and somebody has already said that sometimes we women are our worst enemies. Let's learn to support each other. We share the same challenges as women. So when we're out there, let us, and now in the academy, you've made so many friends. You've made so many networks from different countries. We are sharing our experiences. Let us learn to support each other as women. Nobody knows what we go through more than us. So nobody else out there can help us better than ourselves. So let's have a support network. Let's talk to each other. Let's share the things happening to one another. Where we can help each other, we do. If you're not very good in this and your fellow politician is good in the other thing, support each other. Support each other so that we grow together and we increase our numbers, we increase our voice, we change this world. So it's not about work-life balance. It's not a 50-50. There's no day you'll have a perfect day. Some days will be crazier than others. But we are saying, let us try to make time for the people and the experiences that we value. Let's not lose focus of the bigger picture. Yes, we are getting into politics, but your life has all those spokes that we talked about. Your life has all those things that make up your life. So focus on them and see how to work on them to make yourself better. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Oh, wow. Amazing. Woo! Please, let's have our videos on. Let's have our videos on. Every time Anne speaks, I just feel like she's speaking to me over and over and over. Oh, Anne, thank you so much. Thank you so much. We really appreciate you.
Thank you, Rachel. Thank you all.
Thank you for your commitment and your passion and the work that you've put into this academy, both for Academy 1 and for Academy 2. And one thing that we told our participants is that do not fear to look for support. If you need, do not fear to look for professional support. Yes. If you need someone to help you to just think through, if you need somebody to help you, one of our modules was on communication and PR and branding. If mm-hmm. you need a professional to sit down with you and help you to brand your mark, please do not shy away. And that is one of the messages that we gave to our participants. Do not feel shy. It's your brand, it's yourself, it's your self-care, it's what will make you become a better leader. Because just like you've said, when the inside is shining, then you're able to shine on the outside. So thank you so
much. Definitely.
We thank you for your time. Please feel free to stay with us. Please feel free to listen from us. And we are so excited. Today is our last day and we are so excited about that. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Rachel, and congratulations to all the graduates. This is a beautiful journey. Put the lessons into practice. And like Rachel is saying, get help. That's why we exist. Some of us are leadership coaches. We if you know you have a you need help, and people are here to support you. We want women to grow. Thank you so much, and God bless you all.
Merci. And colleagues, our Anglophone sisters, now we are going Francophone, and you are going to the beautiful country of Benin. So allow you to just go to the interpretation button and to click on it so that you can have and listen in English, because our next speaker is
There you go, Joanne. Wow. So to go to the interpretation button, just go on the, to go to the interpretation button, just click and you will have, you select English now for the Anglophones so that you're able to get the interpretation in English. Mesdames et messieurs, c'est avec grand plaisir que nous avons notre panéliste qui a beaucoup travaillé dans le Bénin. Elle a beaucoup travaillé, elle vient juste d'être élue pendant des élections. Je vais lire sa bio. Une minute. Je vais partager. Allez, c'est ça. C'est Madame Florence. Florence, comment est-ce qu'on dit votre nom, s'il vous plaît?
Eni Ayewu.
Florence.
Eni Ayewu.
Eni Ayewu. Allez. Consultante indépendante, Madame Florence Eni Ayewu. Et elle, titulaire d'une maîtrise en sciences politiques et relations internationales de l'université Abomey-Calavi, UAC, au Bénin, puis d'un master en genre et consolidation de la paix de l'université tchèque Anta Diop au Sénégal. Florence est également certifiée des centres d'excellence de maintien de la paix de la CDAO et des Nations Unies, notamment École de maintien de paix Alioune Blondine Bay du Mali, Kofi Annan International Peacekeeping Training Center du Ghana et du Centre Center of Excellence Stability Police Unit de l'Italie. Elle a été une militante dévouée et membre de plusieurs associations dont la Jeunesse Chambre Internationale Bénin, dont elle a été la présidente locale en 2018 du CREUS Femmes Engagées pour des nominations et des élections paritaires ETT. Honorable Florence est une bénéficiaire du programme de renforcement de capacité d'action de femmes financé par la coopération suisse qui a boosté son militantisme politique et l'a relevé dans sa localité. Elle est également un produit des ateliers de la démocratie phase à démo 1, financé par l'ambassade des États-Unis, puis a été identifiée pour assurer la formation dans les autres localités à travers les phases ADOME 2 et le mini ADOME destiné aux élèves du lycée et lycéens. Lors des élections communales de 2020, elle a été bénéficiée de la confiance de son parti politique et a été positionnée sur la liste qui lui a permis d'être élue conseiller communal dans le département du plateau commune d'Elfanyi. Bravo, bravo. D'abord, bravo, bravo, ma sœur, pour le bon travail. C'est pas facile d'être élue, ça c'est sûr. Et comme une jeune femme, nous sommes vraiment, vraiment fiers de vous. Nous sommes vraiment contentes que vous avez montré que les femmes peuvent être élues. C'est ça. Pour nous, pour les participants de cette académie, pour la participation politique des femmes, quelles sont des stratégies? Qu'est-ce que vous avez fait? Nous sommes vraiment contentes parce que pendant toute la semaine, on a essayé de faire les pratiques, mais en même temps, essayer de partager avec l'expérience. Donc, pour nous, ce qui est très important, c'est d'écouter de vous comment est-ce que vous avez travaillé pour être élu. Ce n'est pas un travail facile. Allez-y, Madame Florence, vous avez la parole.
D'accord, merci beaucoup, Madame Rachel. Et je remercie cette initiative de FAWE. Et c'est par là que j'ai commencé aussi. Il a fallu que des organisations de la société civile pensent à organiser des formations pour que j'en arrive là. Donc, c'est vraiment formidable ce que vous faites. Et je félicite les bénéficiaires qui ont été sélectionnés parce que c'est pas facile aussi d'être sélectionné, de bénéficier d'une telle formation. Alors, je remercie Madame Anne qui vient de passer, de qui j'ai beaucoup appris, parce que c'est le stress au quotidien, mais on essaie de surmonter. J'ai beaucoup appris de sa présentation et je voudrais demander qu'elle veuille bien partager avec moi à la fin. Merci beaucoup. Alors, mon parcours de politicienne, je dirais, je mets ça entre griffes parce que je suis encore au début, a commencé depuis l'université, lorsque j'ai étudié les sciences politiques et relations internationales. Un professeur nous disait d'écouter l'actualité internationale et de faire des exposés chaque matin. Donc, c'est commencé, on était obligé de suivre les débats politiques, l'actualité, et on venait, on commentait, on faisait le débat entre étudiants. Donc, à la fin, je ne me disais pas comment ça va se passer. Je ne savais pas comment m'y prendre. Donc, j'ai commencé par travailler. Et puis après, je suis repartie au Sénégal pour faire le master. C'est au retour du Sénégal en 2016 que j'ai vu la publication d'un consortium d'ONG qu'on appelle Refonga et WANEP. Donc, j'ai postulé à la formation et j'ai été sélectionnée pour suivre cette formation qui a duré 3 ans. Alors, au cours de la formation, il y a eu beaucoup de thématiques sur le leadership, sur l'engagement politique, sur le règlement des conflits. Vraiment, c'était un long parcours et nous avons tenu bon. Nous avons terminé. À la fin de cette formation, ce programme de 3 ans, il nous avait été demandé de rédiger un petit projet à mettre en œuvre. Alors, j'ai réfléchi et j'ai fait un mini projet que je suis allée réaliser dans ma localité d'origine, dans mon village. Et j'ai invité beaucoup de femmes et de jeunes pour venir suivre. Et là, j'ai tout mis. J'ai mis le paquet. Genre, je me suis vendue très cher. J'ai parlé de tout mon parcours académique, de mon militantisme en tant que OSC, parce que j'ai été membre d'une chambre, je suis des formations de leadership. Donc, je leur dis, la première étape, c'est de se faire former. Donc, j'ai fait des projections pour montrer mon parcours. Et c'était vraiment impressionnant. Et c'est dans la salle même, lors de ma présentation, que les jeunes se sont dit, vous êtes de notre qualité, mais qu'est-ce que vous faites? Pourquoi vous ne venez pas travailler à la base pour vous faire porter sur le plan politique? Et je leur ai dit, je suis en réflexion parce qu'il me faut réfléchir pour voir quel parti politique partage mes idéologies. Ils m'ont dit d'accord. Donc, je suis partie. Juste avant, j'avais déjà commencé les démarches pour connaître les partis d'influence dans ma localité. Donc, après, les appels venaient de partout. Il y a une dame qui est venue faire une présentation. On veut savoir qui elle est, qu'est-ce qu'elle fait, c'est quoi son parcours. Parce qu'on veut savoir ce que tu apportes de plus au parti politique. Donc, les gens m'ont appelé. J'ai dit oui, je réfléchis. Finalement, j'ai pris ma décision. Il fallait rencontrer le leader de ce parti dans ma localité. Il m'a reçu, il m'a écouté, mais il m'a dit une phrase que je n'oublierai jamais. C'est vrai que vous êtes de telle localité. Il appelait le nom de mon village. J'ai dit oui, je suis de telle. Il dit d'accord. Nous voulons voir votre force de frappe sur le terrain. Réfléchissez, organisez vous-même une activité, mettez l'activité en œuvre et nous viendrons voir comment ça va se passer. Et là, j'ai compris qu'en politique, on demande beaucoup plus à la femme. Parce qu'un homme qui va en politique, on ne lui demandera pas d'organiser une activité et de mettre en œuvre d'abord. On l'accepte. Parce qu'en politique, c'est les addictions, c'est les multiplications, jamais de soustraction. Donc, on le prend. Mais à la femme, on veut voir comment tu peux impacter. D'abord, ta compétence, ta qualité et ta force de mobilisation. J'ai dit, OK, je suis allée voir ma mère, ma famille, qui a toujours été impliquée depuis le début de la formation dont j'ai bénéficié. Parce qu'il faut rappeler que cette formation a exigé qu'un membre de notre famille nous accompagne. C'est peut-être notre époux ou un parent proche, père ou frère, mais de sexe masculin a priori. Donc, j'ai associé ma mère qui était au village pour la mobilisation. Et ce jour, il y avait du monde. Les gens de mon village ont prouvé qu'effectivement, cette fille, elle a grandi dans ce village, elle a étudié dans le village, même si elle est allée ailleurs après pour étudier, elle est des nôtres. Donc, les gens sont sortis massivement. Et j'ai mis mon argent pour mobiliser parce qu'à la fin, il faut c'était la période des fêtes. Donc, je leur ai dit que c'est pour présenter mes vœux. Donc, j'ai fait à manger suffisamment. Les gens sont venus. Le leader politique était là. Il était impressionné. Et il disait publiquement, voilà la preuve de l'engagement de la dame parce que je ne lui ai pas donné un franc. Et ça m'a fait beaucoup plaisir qu'il le dise publiquement. Donc, j'ai terminé et il est parti. Chacun est parti. Mais moi, de ma posture de communicatrice, de consultante, tout ce que je pouvais faire avec les jeunes, c'était des formations. Donc, je ne manquais jamais d'occasion de partir à la base avec des projets, avec des activités où j'invitais les jeunes. Violence sexuelle, j'étais là pour faire des activités. Engagement politique, j'étais là pour faire des activités. Du coup, mon visage a commencé à être collé à mon nom, que les gens entendaient. Et on était en 2019. En même temps, c'était la période de transition au Bénin. C'est-à-dire qu'il y avait les réformes pour partir du système, vers le système partisan. Donc, les petits partis se sont mis ensemble pour former un bloc, en tout cas plusieurs blocs. Donc, je suis partie vers un des partis politiques qui avait un bloc influent. Et j'ai été vraiment accompagnée parce que quand j'ai décidé d'adhérer à tel parti, ils ont organisé le congrès pour fusionner ces petits partis-là. Donc, je suis rentrée en même temps dans le système et je suis devenue membre fondatrice de ce grand parti politique. Et il faut aussi dire que durant tout le parcours, avant la proposition, le positionnement, il y a beaucoup d'enquêtes sur le terrain. Donc, ils sont allés dans mon collège, ils sont allés dans mon village pour demander, pour poser des questions sur quel type de personne je suis, comment est-ce que je mène ma vie. Et le résultat étant concluant, j'ai été positionnée sur la liste deuxième sur sept sièges. Donc, c'était la deuxième et c'était vraiment inédit parce que je ne faisais pas la politique dans le village depuis 5 ans, 10 ans, non. Je venais d'arriver avec le nouveau parti. Donc, c'est comme ça que j'ai été positionnée, deuxième, et c'est parti pour un autre combat. Lorsque la liste a été publiée, j'ai vu mon nom et je me suis dit, waouh, qu'est-ce que j'ai fait pour mériter cet honneur? C'est vrai que c'est un honneur, même si je l'ai mérité. Je l'ai mérité parce que si j'étais restée les bras croisés, sans mener des activités, sans mobiliser, je ne serais pas arrivée à un tel positionnement. Donc, les partis politiques se sont rendus compte que celle-ci, elle peut nous apporter quelque chose avant de me positionner. Et voilà, la liste a été publiée. Il faut mener les démarches pour la campagne. En même temps, c'était la période de COVID. Et il nous avait été demandé de faire la campagne via Internet. Sauf que, à la base, ils ne sont pas connectés. Nos bonnes dames dans les villages ne sont pas connectées. Ma commune est une commune rurale. Donc, il faut aller au contact de la population. Et je n'avais pas les moyens. Ça, il faut le dire honnêtement, je n'avais pas les moyens parce que je me cherchais encore sur le plan professionnel. Mais la chance que j'ai eue, comme je le disais tantôt, c'était le système partisan qui demande à ce que l'État central finance les partis politiques. Donc, c'est le parti politique qui a mis des fonds à disposition. C'était pas suffisant, mais c'était quelque chose. Et c'est grâce à la répartition en fonction de positionnement, de l'influence de la localité que les fonds ont été repartis pour mener les campagnes. Et pour les campagnes, on ne fait pas cadeau. Hein. Tu es femme, tu es homme, c'est le même combat. Tu te mets en pantalon et voilà, tu vas sur le terrain. Donc, voilà en gros ce qui a été fait. Sauf que après les élections, il fallait maintenant un autre lobbying pour désigner qui serait à quel poste et pourquoi. Donc, moi, je viens d'arriver, c'est vrai, coup de cercle, coup de maître, mais j'ai une aînée qui a été positionnée. Pour moi, c'est déjà un succès qu'on ait au moins une femme dans l'exécutif qui est réservée à 3 personnes. Donc, voilà un peu mes expériences. Si vous avez des questions, je suis là pour répondre. Je vous remercie.
Bravo, 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 Madame Florence. Et bravo, merci beaucoup pour partager avec nous vos expériences, pour nous éduquer, pour nous faire voir comment il faut nous positionner. C'est ça, pour moi, il faut le positionnement. Parce que c'est à partir de ça qu'on peut être vu. Comme vous avez dit, dans le commune, vous n'étiez pas là, vous êtes allé pour des études ailleurs, et après avoir rentré, et c'est à ce moment-là où vous êtes dans le forefront, et puis montrer comment est-ce que vous pouvez être dans cette position. Donc, bravo et merci beaucoup. Et collègues, s'il vous plaît, let's have our videos on and let's just say merci in French. Please say merci, merci to Florence and just appreciate merci. Her. Thank you so much. Merci Florence. Merci, 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 merci beaucoup. Et merci, merci beaucoup pour avoir partagé avec nous votre expérience.
Oui. Madame Rachel, wow. Je peux ajouter une chose?
Oui, allez-y.
Voilà,
allez-y.
Je n'ai peut-être pas reçu d'aide directement de l'État, ce qui est normal puisqu'on vous laisse aller à la base faire votre preuve. Mais il y a les OSC qui nous ont accompagnés. Parce que déjà, le projet dont j'ai bénéficié, c'est les OSC qui l'ont mis sur pied. Et il y a d'autres associations qui m'ont accompagné sur le plan technique. Il y a le Creuset Femmes Engagées pour des nominations et des élections paritaires. Il y a le réseau RFLD, Réseau des Femmes Leaders pour le Développement, qui m'appelait pour me soutenir, pour me déstresser. Madame Anne, je vous rejoins. Pour me dire comment me comporter sur le terrain. Et ma mère, ma famille, tout le monde a été là. Mon conjoint aussi, on m'appelait tous les soirs pour demander comment a été le terrain, comment ça s'est passé, si je ne suis pas trop fatiguée. Donc, vraiment, c'est très important d'avoir des amis et la famille pour soutenir dans ce moment-là. C'était une très belle expérience aussi.
Bravo, bravo et merci beaucoup et merci pour votre pour être là avec nous et pour partager vos expériences. Vraiment, merci beaucoup. J'espère et j'en suis sûre que les participants, ils ont bien apprécié, ils ont appris quelque chose, un ou deux choses qui vont même le faire dans les propres vies et dans les propres stratégies de la campagne et tout. Donc, merci beaucoup. Colleagues, allow me now to welcome. Thank you so much. And amongst us in the room, we have Dr. Pinky Megwe, who is a senior regional advisor, Africa and West Africa from International IDEA. And Dr. Pinky, we are so grateful to have you in the room and so happy to have you here with us. We know you have been crisscrossing the different academies that we have as WPP consortium partners. So Dr. Pinky, you have the floor. You have 5 minutes to go. Please share with us your experience from International IDEA. And here from our program, we said, share with us networking and building solidarity for women in political participation. Dr. Pinky, you have the floor. Please go ahead. And just before Dr. Pinky, ladies and gentlemen, I can see we have our chief guest for our closing ceremony in the room. Professor Sara, you're most welcome. You're most welcome. You're most welcome.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. We're just having our panelists who are sharing with us their different stories with our participants who've been going through the academy this week. And so we are happy to have you and we are honored to have you. So feel most welcome and feel most welcome to be part of us.
Thank you.
Dr. Pinky, please go ahead. Dr. Pinky, are you there? I saw you in the room. Please unmute. Joanne, please unmute Dr. Pinky. I think she's in the room.
Rachel.
Dr. Pinky. Hello, Joanne.
I don't see Pinky here, so
I think she's dropped off. All right. As we wait for Dr. Pinky, probably I know most of our WPP academies are ongoing simultaneously in Kenya, in Eswatini, in Zimbabwe. I know we are all having our day five today, so I know she's been regional trotting from Kenya to Eswatini to Zimbabwe. So I know she will be joining us probably. And I saw her in the room. But allow me now to invite Honorable Hasna Mbone Mudezi, who's the Speaker of Vihiga County Assembly. Honorable Hasna, are you here with us? Honorable Asna, are you here with us?
Hi, Rachel.
Hello, Joanne.
Hey, Khan. Hello,
Joanne. I saw her in the room. So as we wait for our two speakers, allow us to take a 1 minute break just to prepare for our chief guest probably. Joanne, would you please give us an interlude of music for 2 minutes? We can take a bathroom break. We can pick your glass of water as you come back, as we gear towards just having a final closing ceremony. Colleagues, just take a 2 minute bathroom break. Get your glass of water. It's part of self-care also, as Dr. Terry and Ann Carrier let us know that you need to really take care of ourselves. Please, 2 minutes, Joanne, if you give us an interlude of music, that will be in order.
took away. Don't forget we were bought and traded. Ripped from the land and shipped away. It's the inspiration we use to survive. You have to see it with your own cries. Don't play at it up in a ride.
Joanne, and thank you for showing us that Africa is beautiful. There's so much that we have and so much that we can be proud of. Colleagues, I'm excited. I'm excited because we are getting towards the final end of our Academy 2. It's been such a pleasure to have all of you join us, all the participants, all the facilitators, all the guest speakers, for the commitment and the support that you've given us to the success of this academy. So allow me now, before we call in our executive director, Martha, to invite our chief guest, allow me now to invite Honorable Hasna Mbone Mudezi, who's the speaker, the honorable speaker of Vihiga County Assembly. Speaker, I hope I am in order. I hope I am in order. I hope I am in order. So we are so happy to have you here. Please unmute yourself. We are so happy to have you here. We are so excited and we celebrate you, and we are happy to have you here and to really look forward to hearing your experience in terms of corporate meeting politics. I don't even want to empty and say anything more. Honorable Hosna, please, the floor is yours. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. I'm excited. I'm excited that I'm part and parcel of this. My name, as has been introduced, I'm Hosna Mbone Mudezi, the Speaker of Vihiga County Assembly. I'm honored to be part of this conversation. Maybe just to give a brief background of myself, I am an advocate of the High Court of Kenya. I have been practicing as such since 2003 until 2017 that I got to this position of the Speaker of the County Assembly of Vihiga. You understand, as an advocate, our roles and responsibilities are sort of structured. We always refer to provisions of the law, and we refer to the provisions of the law, we refer to evidence that is before the court, as opposed to now this other side. So I can say for me, it was a was a total shift from my norm. It wasn't a cup of tea. I did not have any background in politics. And I found myself in politics because the position of the speaker of any assembly in Kenya, it is advertised. There are requirements and qualifications. And when I applied, then you are put in the category that is qualified. But there's another bit that is there that perhaps in the other world it isn't there. There's the bit of lobbying, because any appointment or
Honorable Hasna, please unmute your microphone. Hello, Honorable Hasna. Honorable Hasna, please unmute your mic. Joanne, please unmute your mic.
Can you hear me?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. We are sorry for that. Please go ahead.
Did it, was I muted all through?
We got to here up to where you said it's an elective, it's a position where you have to apply and uh-huh. and yeah, please okay. go ahead. Yeah, yeah. Sorry yeah. for that.
So, no, it's fine. So once you are you have applied and your credentials qualify you for the position, the other bit is now politics. It's political. You have to lobby, you have to get the numbers, you have to persuade these members to then vote for you. You know, that bit is not there in the normal jobs that we apply. And if you do not have that political background, I'm telling you, I applied, put my papers there and left for Nairobi. And the next call I got, I was told, you need to come back and now get the numbers. It's about democracy, it's about majority. It's about lobbying. So I had to come back, this being a new field, but God was great, so great that I got the job. Majority of the members voted for me. I was the only lady amongst 13 other candidates. And I emerged the successful candidate.
I can't hear her.
You cannot hear me?
I guess you're muted.
No, we can hear you.
No, we can hear you.
Oh, I wasn't hearing her. Okay, thanks.
Okay, sorry.
Sorry.
Please go ahead.
So that was the beginning of my journey. And I now found myself in the position of the speaker of an assembly. We, in the structure of governance of Kenya, we have the national government and the county government. And so the assembly is the other arm of a devolved system of government. So if I can explain the structure of county government, we have the executive, which is headed by the governor, His Excellency the governor. And then we have the legislative arm of the county government, which is headed by the speaker on the other side. So I found myself in this position, and believe you me, you start without knowing which direction, what is where. But I thank God because I got a lot of support from the women who were in that house, and also the men, because it is very interesting that you are supposed to begin executing your roles and your duties as the head of the institution and as the speaker immediately. The day you are sworn in is the day you are supposed to execute your roles and duties. And you know, no one will teach you how to say order, order, order. You have to learn it on the very day. But little by little, I can say that a lot of support from members, a lot of support from the women in that house that gave me the courage. My background and my personality, I am that quiet person. I would be, as I said, the legal profession is a bit structured, even not a bit, but more structured. So you do not have that political environment that I was now facing. So you need a lot of courage from the women who went through election and political line or road to guide and give you that courage. And yes, I started and we took almost a year, committed to training all of us. Lucky enough, majority of my members were also, was their first time to be politicians. And we sort of learned together. I can say we have grown together, you know, as a family. My house is very vibrant. They are fairly young people. So you don't feel offended when they correct you. I mingle with them. I listen to them. The secret, I tell you, nobody will give you the formula. No one will take you to class and tell you, this is how you're supposed to deal with leaders. No, you find your own formula. My formula has been to listen. And that has worked for me very well. I think I have had a fairly a smooth running assembly. I think I have tried to achieve, better than the major roles that we have as an assembly, because our major roles as stipulated under our Constitution 2010 is legislation, oversight, and representation. And as far as representation is concerned, I can say without any fear of contradiction that I looked at legislation. Legislation is making laws, a role that we are obligated to do as an assembly or to undertake as an assembly. But legislation entirely relies on the executive. They have to bring the bills so that we process the bills and then until we get the laws. And then oversight, we have to wait for the executive to implement so that we are able to oversight. But now representation, we are a representation of the people. We represent the people. So I picked the role of representation and I said, in my tenure, I will focus to better representation. And that's when I sat with my board and we formulated a policy to enhance public participation. I felt that we all undertake public participation, but the question is it effective? So during my tenure, I have focused and put a lot of energy on public participation, involvement of the people we represent, to close that gap between the governed and us as the leaders, or the leaders and those we represent. So I started a program dubbed Bunge Mashinani. It's enhancing public participation. I am so happy that we launched the program. We went further than just having a policy in place, but we have put legislation in place so that whether I am there or not, the Vihiga County Assembly is compelled to go to the people, to take the bunge or the assembly to the people, so that we are able to interact, we are able to close that gap, we are able to listen to them and appreciate. For example, what is a priority? What would be a priority of our people? Is it water? Is it road? Is it help? So that when we sit back at the assembly, we are able to actually represent the people. Otherwise, as it is now, I am so happy because the program was launched in 2019 by the Speaker Senate, Honorable Kenneth Lusaka. And out of that, we even attracted friends and donors. We got, the other day, we went to receive a check of 3 million from the Chinese government, Chinese embassy. And I am now good to go. Other than what we have budgeted in our budget assembly, we are now attracting donors and friends and partners so that we can enhance public participation of the people. If you remember, even the BBI case that was just concluded the other day, one of the major issues that was pointed out by those petitioners who went to court was the issue of public participation. So it's not that we don't do public participation. Public participation is undertaken by every county assembly and even the national parliament, but is it effective? How do we question the issue of law, whether or not we need degrees? Yet this is a law that was passed many years back. It has been deferred in terms of implementation twice. 2017, 2013, this is a law that has been in existence. If public participation was effective, then we would all have been aware and we could have been informed that there is a law that is about to be passed. Does it offend some of us? We could have raised those petitions. We could have given our views in terms of how practical, how balanced is that kind of law to be applicable to all Kenyans? Do all Kenyans have a degree? Maybe another discourse could have been, are we bordering between discrimination or not, you know, for purposes of implementation or approving that kind of law? So I strongly believe that you have to find your formula, you have to take advantage of the positions we hold to better our governance, to better the main roles that we have been entrusted with. Otherwise, as a woman, I would tell you, no one will teach you some of these things. As I said, you have to find your way. I try to balance. There are a lot of expectations from the society. There's always that doubt. Will she manage? Will she make it? But you find your own formula, as I said, and you ensure that you implement, you try to gain the efficiency in executing your roles and responsibilities. Otherwise, I'm very glad it's about inspiring each one of us. Everyone is eligible. Everyone is able to be a leader. It is just the mindset. We are able. If I manage, I never had a political background, but right now I'm very happy. I have my program dubbed Bunge Mashinani. It is anchored in law. It's being supported by partners and even the Ministry of Devolution. And for me, even if I'm not there tomorrow, I believe I've left a legacy. And before I close, I am so happy because of Bunge Mashinani. We are about 3 or 4 counties that are going to the people that are enhancing public participation. Makueni is one of them, Kajiado is one of them, Kisumu also they are doing it, but the difference with Vihiga, we have put legislation in place. We have anchored it in law, and that gave us, we were recognized in the last Gala Awards, the County Gala Awards. I was awarded the best speaker within Western Region. And my assembly was also recognized as the best county assembly. I take pride in that, and I really thank God because it is an effort of all of us. My members did appreciate my guidance, did support me in what I thought was very critical for us. And that is why I managed to be the best speaker. In fact, I asked them, why, you know, why me? What is it that I've done that is extraordinary? But they picked out on just that. And of course, the sobriety within my assembly. I thank God I've never had, the throwing of chairs, of being harassed by my assembly, because I believe in sitting down, understanding and listening to your members. Even if I'm the head of the institution, even if I'm the speaker of the county, but it is not about me. It's about the leadership. All the members in that house are leaders. So before I make that decision, I consult. I ensure that we are moving together. And that has been my formula. And I thank God so far, I have done 4 years. I keep asking myself, I have done 4 years, you know. Now I pray that we finish the remainder of this term and for proper and better service delivery. If I can offer more, I pray that I'll still be there to offer Absolutely. More and more service. Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Whoa. Wow, wow, wow. Colleagues, please, please, let's have our video on. We have to celebrate Vihiga as the best county. I mean, the county assembly is the best county assembly, and with a woman captain at the ship, I mean, steering that ship, women must lead, women must lead. And that is a good, good, good. We are excited, honorable. I hope we are in order. Please, please, I hope we are in order. We are in order, order, order to celebrate you. Please, let's all.
Thank you. Thank you.
Please, thank you. Thank you so much. Please, let's all celebrate. And thank you so much, Honorable Hasna. We celebrate you. We value you. We are here. We are here behind you. We appreciate you, and we are here in solidarity with you. Thank you so much, thank and thank you for the amazing work that you're doing in Vihiga County. We appreciate you, and thank you also for finding time to be with us. It's a privilege and it's an honor today. Being
you guys are doing a good job. Yeah, no, you guys are doing a good job. As I said, I it's about people inspiring you. Mm-hmm. If you hear my story, somebody else will be inspired. Mm-hmm. And what you're doing, you are. I wish people would know the impact it would have to many who would feel, can I really do this? Mm-hmm. Can I manage this? As I said, my background, I don't like conflict at all. Mm-hmm. But you imagine, how best can I contribute to the society? Mm-hmm. If this position is there, if God gives me that position, mm-hmm. you have to stand up to the occasion. And if it's not for the inspirational stories we hear, if it's not about, encouragement from our fellow women, from even anybody who has been there before, you know, sometimes you would say, no, this one, I don't think so. So I also want to really appreciate you and your team and what you're doing, because you're bringing us together. If I hear somebody else's story, it will encourage me more. So thank you also, Rachel.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Honorable Hasna. We appreciate you, and thank you for really, really, really being part of our closing today. We have been here for 5 days. We have participants from Vihiga. Oh, I can see the chat is on fire. Your people are here.
My people are here.
Your people are here. Your people are here, and they're excited to see you. Wow, thank you so much.
Wow. Thank you.
Thank you, colleagues. This is amazing. This I'm happy. It's been a 5-day engaging learning, and the inspirational stories that we are getting from our guest speakers, it's priceless. You cannot even put a price on it, because it's these inspirational stories that really is pushing all of us to this journey, to this course for women in political participation. I can see Dr. Pinky in the room. Dr. Pinky would like to just find out if you're able to just briefly, before we hand over the program to our executive director, who will now invite our keynote speaker for the closing ceremony. Dr. Pinky, I don't know if you can hear me now.
Yes, ma'am, I can hear you.
Absolutely, Dr. Pinky, there you are, and we are happy and excited. I was just telling all the participants in the room that today you have been in like 7 African countries, crisscrossing from Eswatini, crisscrossing to Kenya, to Zimbabwe. You have, yes. I'm so sorry, it's been such a busy, busy long day for you, crisscrossing all over the continent and just giving us all that support we need. Dr. Pinky, please talk to us before we invite Martha to invite our keynote address and our chief guest for the closing ceremony. You have the floor, Dr. Pinky. Go ahead.
Thank you so very much, Rachelle. Thank you. Thank you so very much. I know we were told then to say no, but it can be so difficult to say no when things are this exciting. I think I will learn after today. I need to apologize beforehand. My connection is terribly wavy. I'm going to therefore try as much as possible to make my intervention very short.
Okay. Please unmute. Please kindly unmute Dr. Pinky. Please kindly unmute. Dr. Pinky, we cannot hear you. Please kindly unmute.
Oh, my apologies. The connection is so bad. It keeps cutting me off. Can you hear me now? Is it okay now?
No. Yes, we can hear you.
Wonderful. Let me see how quickly I can say just how happy I am, not only to be here today at the closing of the Academy that is being hosted by FAWE, but to be a part of this consortium that is being led by the organization that I work. Gender work is at the center of our efforts at facilitating and strengthening democracy worldwide. One of our flagship products is the Global State of Democracy. Every 2 years, we reflect on how the world is doing in terms of democracy and all the various attributes to democracy, while obviously paying close attention to the notion of gender and to women in political participation thereof. In 2019, we looked again at how we were doing in terms of WPP. And when we look at how we're doing in WPP terms, quite often we look at three key elements. I'm talking in very broad terms. We look at representation, we look at empowerment, and we look at influence. And so in taking stock, we asked ourselves, how well have we done across these three areas? Who is doing the work? And what are the challenges, particularly the intractable challenges? Now, when we look at representation, we're talking about numbers. Usually these are very easy to take a look at. And we could see that we had a terribly uneven set of representation statistics. In some areas of our continent, we were doing well. In others, we had done well before, but we're not doing quite as well. In yet others, we were doing despicably badly. And so in asking, but who is doing this work? We were really asking because we understood that there were organizations that had been doing this important work of supporting women to participate actively in politics over a long period of time. We also understood that the challenges to women's political participation were many. Intractable, yes, but also many. And that if we were to advance in terms of the work that had been done, we had to take these into consideration. Who's doing what? What's the expertise there? How much more needs to be done? But also, what are the stumbling blocks that do not allow us to work together? Because we understood too and had come to understand over time that fragmentation can also be an issue. Can be an issue in terms of whether you are able to attract together your resources, your voice, in order that you can convince those that are in power, so to speak, to effect change. And so it was important to take a look and see. International IDEA, in any case, works through partners. We believe that those that are within communities, those that fully understand the context, are best placed to do the work on the ground. And so we talk about facilitation, about support, and about collaborating. We talked to various different organizations that have been doing work in the arena of WPP over time on the continent. And we ended up with a set that we thought would bring together different strengths. PADARI in Zimbabwe would cover a part of Southern Africa that required a lot of work. But they were also bringing an interesting strength in that they worked primarily with communities of men. We thought, let's also look at who can bring in the strength of law, reenacting, looking at constitutions, and ensuring that we do better in that sphere. And WOLSA became a partner and a member of the consortium because they've been doing this work for a long time. They have registered good success. They also work across different countries. And so we're working now with WOLSA in Zimbabwe and Eswatini, FAWE. What can I say about FAWE that you don't know? FAWE brings the strength of education, sits in East Africa, has worked with various different organizations over time. The pedigree is not to be questioned at all. And so we thought, education, very important. We could do better in this arena. And we could do better not only at educating at the highest level, but at all the different levels where FAWE is already present. We also brought in GenderLinks, an organization that started off looking at social justice primarily from the perspective of the media and how you can use the media towards gender equality, representation, but also just ensuring that women's voices are heard. GenderLinks has over time led with respect to changing policy, particularly in the SADC area. They also do training. And they came up with a barometer member states to the promises that they made with respect to gender and development. And we thought we actually could use something like this that allows us to track, first to see where we are, hold a mirror to ourselves, but also to track where we are doing. So GenderLinks was bringing part of that as well as the other dimensions that I have spoken to. We also thought, look, we need to make sure that we have a partner that can assist us within this consortium with the strength of networking and the media, a partner like FemNet that already understands how you pull together networks of women's work to do the important work of focusing on particular aspects and using different platforms, digital and otherwise. And so FemNet became a natural partner. Sheikh Hamza Job University, their gender lab is one of the oldest on the continent. And it also has become a member of our consortia. Its strength, obviously being within a university research, but we also thought it brings an interesting aspect to one of the barriers that we find ourselves confronted with on the continent, a different language. These are colleagues that would be able to tackle issues in French and to extend our network into French-speaking Africa. But also Sheikh Hamza Job, quite apart from being the oldest, is probably the biggest university on the continent. There you also therefore find young, this august set of members that allow us to network and to do the necessary work. But together, we then curated. We need more knowledge. And so we need to create knowledge products. We need to know more about why we are facing the kinds of problems that we are facing.
why they remain so intractable over time, what it is that we could do differently, better, what have we done that has actually taken us a step further? Why in the areas that we have regressed, have we regressed? We also identified another area that requires work, dialoguing. We need to dialogue, continue dialoguing, dialogue better, dialogue across even areas that we haven't necessarily always worked in. Those usually that work in education tend to stay in education. We said we were crisscross in terms of our dialoguing. Here is another manner in which we are dialoguing with this academy. Here is education at work as well. But in dialoguing too, we want to pay attention to mentoring. We want young people. We want older, experienced people. We want young politicians. We want those that still want to come into politics and those that can share stories of how they have been able to navigate the landscape. We thought networking is so important. It is going to be necessary to create opportunities for networking at various different levels. Sometimes young women need to be alone and to talk to one another. Some of us get left out and we wish we could hear what they are talking about. We've created some rooms of that nature for them. But we believe it is important that they can talk to one another. Sometimes it's important that we can exchange across our different areas of work, across our areas of expertise, across age, across geography. And this is what the consortium also allows its members and those that it works with. We also do this work across geography, across language, as I indicated. We thought we also will need to pay attention to empowerment. Remember, not only do we want to take up the numbers, we want to see those that get in, those that want to get in, and those that are already there. How do we capacity enhance? And so we need to come up with training that takes care of all the different levels. You exchange, you point towards, you provide the knowledge products. And so that becomes part and parcel of the capacity enhancement. We talked at length about how representation and empowerment have not always led to concomitant influence. We have some women that have been in politics for a long time, and yet we don't see them carrying along other women, young or older, whatever the case. We don't see transformation in terms of gender equality, even though some of those women are there. What is hampering them? What do they need to do in order that they can help the case of bringing along more women so that not only is there representation, but they are empowered and they become influential in order that we do not keep seeing the same sets of problems over and over again. And so we thought it would be necessary to zone in on influence. Sometimes it requires that those that are already politicians are equipped, that they know what is needed of them if they are going to influence policy change. How do you go about enacting a new policy? How do you go about selling it? How do you go about selling yourself? How do we also deal with problems that were brought up at the time, such as some people call it, will borrowing because you brought in any case, by your political organization and your political party expects that you toe the line. How do we ensure that we support, assist, so the women can be part of the political parties that they want to be a part of, but are also independently
capacitated as it were, and resourced as much as is possible. We talked about how it would be important also to pay attention to policy, engage for policy change, yes, locally, but also with our various RECs, the AU, and much more globally, because women's work and WPP work especially is not island work. It is all intricately linked to communities, to society, to the whole world, as it were. And I spoke about the barometer, how we would need to create that barometer in order that we can hold up a mirror to ourselves, to our political leaders, our countries, to our continent, as it were, and to the whole world. How is Africa doing? We started all this work in the beginning across 8 countries. We identified 8 countries in order that we could be as focused as is possible and to be able to do a deep diving. We chose those countries and by looking at, we sampled, we said, let's take a few that are doing well. Let's take a few that have been doing well but have regressed. And then let's take a few that are doing very badly. And we focused on those. But for the barometer, we said it would be important to do all 54 countries of the continent. And in doing so, we would also be able to see where the gaps are in terms of information. And then we could possibly work on ensuring that we gather that necessary data for us to be able to monitor how well we are doing with regard to a WPP landscape on the continent. So how have we done? I'd say two. It's not easy to do this kind of work. And it is not easy to create such a formation, but it is necessary. Also, secondly, it can be done. Here we are, we're doing it. It doesn't have to necessarily be easy. Sometimes it is from the difficulties that things get better and better and better. We have found, for instance, that in as much as we all are working towards one ideal, we have different levels of ability as organizations. We have different levels of resources in terms of funding, resources in terms of people, even accessibility. Resources in terms of being able to access the different offices that we need to access in order to do this work as well as we possibly can. We learned about organizational ability and the running of organizations as we were going along, that in certain areas we needed to strengthen our governance, first as a consortium, but also as different organizations in their own right, because there are some elements of governance that when they are strong, one is able to better attract funding. Sometimes it's also small things like, they're small but they're big, like reporting. How well do you do it? We've been learning from each other. And I believe bettering one another, not always easily, but we're doing it. We found that we are also extending our reach. We're extending our reach thematically, geographically, in terms of language and all of that. In Eswatini today, they're talking across to young women, older women, people that have been in politics a long time, those that are just coming in. I think coming from different angles. I believe it is the same thing that has happened here at this academy. We're also learning about our different communities. We're learning about ourselves. I find we're learning adaptability and creativity, especially because we have been tested so much by the COVID-19 pandemic. We found that we had to continue working together, but doing so differently and to pay attention to working together and alone. We found that we've had to learn to identify new challenges, but also new opportunities. We found we are also creating new formations that are evolving out of this original consortium. Some of our partners are coming together to create working forces, small consortia, in order that they can focus on certain other aspects, which means not only have they gained strength in terms of collaborating, they've also gained credibility from the footmarks that have been created recently. They're able to get funding, and they are able, much more importantly, to direct much more energy towards this work of WPP on the continent. It can be done. We have It can be done because we have created analysis by country, aid, we've produced policy briefs, so the knowledge is there. We have a website that has a lot of information that can be used by other organizations, and they can use it for free. We have a book that is ongoing. We have media training that has taken place. We have that barometer for everybody to use as a resource. We've also come to realize very excitedly, because we exchange news on a daily basis within our, particularly within our WhatsApp group, that there is a distinct set of winds of change that is blowing across the WPP landscape in Africa right now. Zimbabwe, Zambia, Uganda, you name it. There's a lot that is going on. More representation seems to be happening. It seems there's a bit more empowering. We're not quite sure yet how far we have gone along the path of influence. And we would like to track that much more avidly as we go forward. How much of the change across the continent is attributable to WPP Africa and to each of our partners more directly? We have recorded some of that, but tracking attribution much more directly remains a challenge, but it's a good challenge. And it's important that we have recognized it as a challenge, because it means that we will be able to work at it as we go forward. And so finally, we have been told that we should not operate like we are on fire, but we have also come to understand that we are on fire. With the COVID-19 pandemic, pretty much all of our problems, our challenges have been brought to sharper bear, as it were. They've been brought into sharper focus. Some of them have been made worse. The inequality gap seems to have gotten bigger. We've seen a spike in gender-based violence, not at least in the area of WPP. We've seen funding go down in certain parts of the continent that could have gone towards WPP. So yes, we are on fire. But we've also come to learn that much as we are on fire, we can be the fire. Thank you.
We can be the fire. Please, that's a very strong parting shot, Dr. Pinky. We are on fire and we can be the fire. Thank you so much. Colleagues, please let's all have our video and just to appreciate Dr. Pinky. Thank you so much for creating time to be with us. And thank you so much for crisscrossing the continent from one academy to the other, and for the commitment and for the work that you're doing. We really appreciate you. We thank you so much. I do not want to take any more second because our chief guest has been here with us, really following with us. Allow me now, ladies and gentlemen, to hand over the program to our executive director,
Martha, who will in turn invite our chief guest. Martha, the floor is yours. Thank you so much. Martha, please unmute.
Disale. Sorry. Yeah. So thank you again. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, everyone. And thanks for being part of this. I know it has been a long week, but we do appreciate all of you for the stamina. And I want to believe we have been here all this long because the conversations are very interesting. The conversations are very educative. Thank you. My job is simple. This afternoon, I would like to introduce our chief guest who is going to close the 1 week training. And the guest that we have for this afternoon is none other than Professor Sarah Anyang Agbor. And allow me just say one or two words about Professor Sarah. Professor Sarah, most important, is an African, but specifically a Cameroonian. And she's a professor of African and Commonwealth literatures. She is also currently the vice president of the FAWE Africa Board. And moving on, Her Excellency Professor Sarah is the African Union Commissioner for Human Resources, Science and Technology since July 2017. But before she joined the African Union, she was also the Deputy Vice Chancellor in charge of research, cooperation, and relations with the business world that is in the University of Bemada, which is found in northwestern region of Cameroon. As Deputy Vice Chancellor, Professor Sarah promoted research efficiently and effectively. She also managed the university's education and research programs, as well as overseeing initiatives and action plans in university's research strategic planning. Her Excellency Professor Sarah also has served as Inspector of Academic Affairs at the Ministry of Higher Education in Cameroon. She has held strategic leadership positions. She has participated in academic planning and ensuring quality. She has been part of the teaching and the learning process. Most important also to mention is that Her Excellency Professor Sarah was the focal point for the Pan-African University, and then also a focal point for the Conference of Ministers of Education in Africa, that is COMADEF. And I want to mention to all of us that we didn't have a better option of the guest for this afternoon other than Professor Sarah. Professor Sarah, you make us proud. For those that have interacted with Professor Sarah, you will agree with me that she's a woman that has walked many walks, and she has a lot to share with us. We have a lot to learn from her. For the years I've known her, she's vibrant. And she will tell you by herself of the journey in politics. You know, when we talk about politics, all of us are political animals in nature. Mm. Irrespective of where you are, there is politics. At workplace, there is politics. Or in the market, there is politics. In supermarkets, there is politics. So politics is everywhere. And we are privileged to have you, Professor Sarah. And allow me to invite you to talk to us and to close the training. Thank you so much, and you're welcome.
Thank you very much, my sister Marta. I'm very, very humbled by your words. I have been sick for 2 weeks. You can hear from my voice. And that was why yesterday I couldn't make it to the meeting that we were supposed to hold together. Sincere apologies. I want to sincerely thank the previous speakers, because I joined and I've been listening to you, the guest speakers, the trainers, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I greet you all on this august occasion where we are closing this training academy. First and foremost, I would like to express my gratitude to you all for allowing me to address you today at the close of the second week of the Virtual Women in Political Participation Academy Training. What a great idea, what a great initiative. Sincere gratitude to the organizers and the facilitators. Rachel, I want to say that you're a very good moderator because your smile has not ceased since I joined and I've been listening to you. And I love the way you welcome people. You make us have a sense of belonging. All of you, your presence and participation in the training is a testament for good leadership. And the Bible says we must give unto Caesar what is Caesar. It is our role to participate in politics. And my sister Martha said it very well, that in the journey of life, there are different kinds of politics, whether in the job place, whether in marriage, whether in your culture, whether in the church, whether in the marketplace. Even as a student, there is politics. Now we need to recognize that. And people believe that to rise up to politics, we must start at the high post. No, you start from the very beginning. Where you are, begin to show your leadership, your leadership package that you have, and people will begin to believe in you. It's been so interesting sharing the testimonies and the words of the many participants who have been speaking since morning. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, this academic training has come at the best time, a time whereby young women such as yourselves are beginning to realize that leadership and good leadership, for that matter, is not dictated by age, rather it is a calling. And that is why I appreciated my brother Barasa when he said in his speech, women are our mothers, women are our sisters, they are our wives, they are daughters, we must treat them responsibly. To treat them responsibly is to empower them. And that empowerment does not come at an old age. From the very beginning, you begin to train your girls to become the kind of people you want them to be. When I was growing up, my father used to say something, self-dignity, self-value, self-esteem, self-respect. Nobody can give it to you except you give it to yourself first. And if you make yourself come, fowls will eat you. And it has never ceased in my mind. I always use this quotation when I'm speaking. I agree with the voice of Miriam Makeba that girls are the future mothers of our society. And it is important that we focus on their well-being. And this is what Fawer does. Even as I'm privileged, humbled, and honored to be the vice president of Fawer, I met Fawer when I went to visit one of their training centers where they had a place for teenage pregnant girls to go to school, a model school. And by the side, they had a nursery for those who already have had children. They can keep their children, come out for breastfeeding and continue their work. As is rightly said, nobody can empower us except we empower ourselves. So our keynote speaker this week mentioned the importance of sitting at the feet of older women. Honorable Professor Jacqueline Odu, she mentioned that she was mentored by one of Africa's exemplary women, Honorable Dr. Phobe Asiyo. Mentorship is very important, and that is why the chairperson of the African Union Commission, His Excellency Dr. Musa Faki Muhammad, in 2019, launched the 1 million by 2021 initiative with four E's. The E of engagement, which is what we are doing, by engaging with the youth, by engaging with the women, we are mentoring them. The E of education, Nelson Mandela said it, that education is the greatest weapon that can transform the world. It is not only entering the four walls of a classroom, but exactly what you have done in this academy through this training is an aspect of education. Employment, when a woman has her own employment, she can speak for herself, no matter how small the salary is, so that we are no longer so much dependent
on our men for what we need, but we are independent. And the last one is entrepreneurship. And I believe that when you speak of the fourth industrial revolution, it is about small and medium-sized businesses. And who are those who are founded? It is women. Therefore, that is a leadership that we need to encourage women to have. I urge you to listen to these older women and pay attention to their experience and how they tackle their challenges. Life is not easy. The road is not easy. It is rough, it is hilly, it is mountainous. But what they say is that when the going gets tough, the tough gets going. There will be times you weep. There will be times you will regret. But what is most important is what you do after weeping and after regretting, picking up the broken shutters and starting all over again. And that does not make you a failure. It makes you an optimist. It makes you as somebody who wants to succeed. This is the importance of this intergeneration dialogue that we are having. As young women of ages between 18 and 35 years, the world is just beginning to discover your strength. For centuries, the main role of women your age was to give life, nurture, and take care of domestic needs. You were to be seen and not to be heard. It is therefore not come as a surprise that many people that you will encounter in your journey to leadership will try to use you and take advantage of you. Moreover, you need to try and try again. Believe in yourself. You must have the courage to push against all the odds. Nobody can do it for you except yourself. Because if you don't believe in yourself, how do you stand to convince people to believe in yourself? Courage is the ability to look at inadequacies and failure, and you gather momentum to try again, trust again, live again, hope against hope, my dear sisters. And many will even use you, and they will say again that you have gotten there by bottom power because they are scared of what you've achieved. So what? So will not want to recognize your prowess, your intelligence. And so what? And grow their biases and prove your work by bringing quality and grace to the job you want to do and becoming actionable and deliverable. Again, I will re-echo the advice given by our keynote speaker, Honorable Professor Jacqueline. Do not give in because it will only give you a false sense of power and leave you with no confidence. Do not give up your power or dignity. Your dignity is very important. The women who went before you paved the way despite the numerous challenges they encountered for daring to go after leadership position. Like I said, there will be name callings. The African Union recognizes that gender equality is a fundamental human right and an integral part of regional integration, economic growth, and social development. And because of this, it has developed the African Union strategy for gender equality and women's empowerment to ensure the inclusion of women in Africa's development agenda. We are women. I'm proudly women. I'm proud to be a woman. Today, some things have changed, but the world is yet to fully embrace female leadership, as evidenced by the number of female presidents and those serving in parliament globally. But the good thing about the African Union Commission is that we believe in gender parity. And presently, we have the first ever female vice chair of the African Union in the person of Her Excellency, Dr. Monica. The next generation is looking for you to stretch out your hand and guide them. But first, you must leave a mark. Substantial stride must be made today to make the experience even better. But now, we cannot do business as usual. No way. I've heard many people saying that as I listen today. We need to examine our core values. We need to have a mission statement. We need to have a vision and form synergies with like minds and in an institution. Having women in leadership positions will help to guide the world towards a place of gender equity, and it will open opportunities. If the vision of the African Union, Agenda 2063, if that vision of an integrated, prosperous, and peaceful Africa, driven by its own competent and skilled citizens, able to play in the world arena, and the bulk of our population and youth, and after that we have women, where are we if we do not give them the competencies that they deserve? But those competencies too must come with you desiring to be competent, to be skilled, to make a difference, and to be the difference in what you want. It is very important. So women work so hard and they bring in deliverables. I take examples from the African Union Commission that I have served, that the different commissioners in the areas of rural economy, agriculture, Her Excellency Ambassador Josepha Sako, the Commissioner for Social Affairs, who is Her Excellency, and the former Minister, Mrs. Amira El Fadi, then the Commissioner for Political Affairs, who is Her Excellency Aminata Somata, and then the Commissioner for Infrastructure and Energy, who is still the incumbent Commissioner for the next 4 years, Her Excellency Dr. Amani Abuzel. I take example from the Deputy Chairperson of the African Union Commission from 2021 to 2025. We hold meetings from 8 a.m. to 10 p.m. and she's seated right there. It is not about gender, saying that you are a woman, you cannot work. But the vision and the mission that you want to accomplish gives you the passion and the strength to continue to work so that people can believe in what you do. We are mentors and we must keep the fire burning. I like what Dr. Pinky said. We should not be envious in fragmenting ourselves and dishing out PhDs. When I use the PhD, I'm talking about pull her down. We should not pull ourselves down. When you don't like a person, you want to pull her down by backstabbing, by blackmailing, by saying nasty things about the people which are not true. That is not what we are for. And I see that in our meeting, the Forum for African Women Education is, we speak more of integrity and the value of trust and hope and the need to make initiatives and change, that we ourselves must be replicas of those changes that we want. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, why is it that when a woman is successful, they call her names, and we women also join them to call them names? That is not right. I cannot undermine the work of FAWE, the Forum for African Women Educationists, that fight for women empowerment and liberation, working with synergies, with presidents, with other institutions that are like-minded with them. As such, distinguished ladies, dynamic daughters of Africa, let's change the narrative. Let's think of each other. Let's empower one another for the global good. I agree with Dr. Pinky Megwe that we need to look out for one another and not towing the line of political parties blindly and negatively. We have different abilities, responsibilities, and assets. And we must be able to use these resources. As we conclude the second week of the Women in Political Participation Academy, I would like to wish you all the best in your respective leadership journeys. You have been equipped with skills to face the upcoming elections and beyond. You are our gallant soldiers in this journey to increasing the participation of women in leadership. Daughters of Africa, claim your space and take courage, because your time is now. Not just this, but remembering that the world is as we have created it and as we think it. Lead as good leaders. We must manage people, make decisions, plan, and set objectives of what you want to achieve, building blocks through network and synergies. My sisters, my mothers, and my daughters, as a woman who believes in the importance of education for the emancipation of the woman, I advise you to develop yourself through lifelong learning. As a deputy chair of the board of the United Nations for lifelong learning, I believe that lifelong learning will make a difference for the Africa we want by 2063. Take away the fear factor. Try to be different by creating your own space of goals. Create your own goals, because without goals, you cannot achieve anything. Accept all criticisms positively and try to buy over your contestants and opponents. Be a progressive political militant. Stand with determination and leave footprints of legacies. Start where you are right now, in your church, among your colleagues, in your community gathering, in your village. Choose a political party, join a party, and change the narrative. Each time I stand to speak, I know I represent a lot of people at all levels, and they must be encouraged. Remember, daughters of Africa, doing something and making mistakes is better than doing nothing at all. Change must come, and now our leadership must take the challenge of digital leadership too. That is why I was speaking about lifelong learning. Realize your potential and dream big. Marriage, wifehood, motherhood should not be barriers to you achieving your dreams. And having said this, I sincerely want to thank Fawe and all the organizers for this wonderful training on Women in Political Participation Academy. I am so honored, I'm so humbled, and I'm so proud of all of you. And I know together we are stronger. I will end my speech by quoting our dear mother, President Ellen Johnson, a Nobel Prize winner. She said, "The size of your dreams must always exceed your current capacity to achieve them." The size of your dreams must always exceed your current capacity to achieve them. If your dreams do not scare you, they are not big enough. Let's be the change makers, bold, resilient, humble, prayerful, to make Africa the tree of life. Thank you very much. And a blessed new month of September. Thank you, Martha, and thank you for organizing this. And thank you, Rachel, for being a wonderful moderator. And to all my sisters who spoke before me, you all spoke very well, and you echo my thoughts. Amasekinalu, as we say in Ethiopia, Asante Sana. Thank you.
Wow, thank you, thank you. Let's all have our videos, and this is where we...
Thank you.
Thank you. Wow. What a way to end our academy. What a way to end our WPP Academy. What a way. Nothing else to say. Thank you so much, Martha, our captain, for steering this ship, for believing in us, for pushing us as Fawe team and saying we can make it. Let's do it. Thank you for the support. Thank you for being an amazing captain and pushing us and ensuring that this academy is a success. We thank you so much. Thank you, facilitators. I don't want to go through the thank you, because already Grace already did it, and she did it so well. For now, in terms of logistics, Miss Joanne, I know you want us to take a group photo. I know, Joanne. Joanne, I know deep down you want us to take that beautiful group photo. Those who want to take 1 minute and unleash your videos, please do that so that you take a group photo.
I know Joanne wants us to take a group photo. Joanne, I know. Joanne, are you ready?
Yes, I am. I am ready.
Thank you. Thank you, Joanne. And please unleash your video also. We want to see Joanne. Joanne, we want to see you. We have been seeing you virtually, but now we want to see you physically. And this is a beautiful photo. Wow, wow. Please smile. Betty Chepkirui, we can see you. Betty, we can see you. Shem, my colleague, and my colleagues, Emily, and Shem, and Michael Longus, and Joanne. Thank you, colleagues. Thank you for your support. Joanne, please tell us when we need to smile. Please, Joanne.
Can we pause for the photo?
Yes, please.
Yes, please. Please unleash those. Oh, there is Joanne. Joanne, we can see you. Please tell us when we need to smile.
I think everyone is okay. That was great.
Thank you, colleagues.
Thank you.
Joanne, have you taken the photo?
One last one.
Ah, Joanne, okay.
Thank you, everyone. It's done.
Thank you so much, colleagues. Thank you. Please, this is the part where we allow you to.
Professor Sarah.
Yes.
Professor Sarah. I want to convey a message. You're muted, but I'm in Addis next week. I'm looking for you. I sent you an email, Professor Sarah.
Okay, I'm muted.
Yes. I'm looking for you next week. We need to agree on something.
Okay, no problem. I'll be going to Addis on Sunday.
Okay. I also arrive on Sunday.
Yes, I'm going to Addis on Sunday, and I will arrive on Sunday.
Okay, I will say.